You on the authority of Scripture, and my text is the words of our Lord in John 10:35. The Scripture cannot be broken. And if the Son of God is true, if the words of the Son of God are true, and the Scripture can't be broken, then what we have in the Bible makes considerable demands on all men and women. If Christ is to be believed, that this book is the word of God and the judge of mankind, and it binds everybody who will consider it, then it has a unique authority. It is to be obeyed simply because it is the word of God. God is its author, and Scripture then has the authority of God. Now, there are some people who want to make conscience the ultimate authority of conduct. They say with Pinocchio, always let your conscience be your guide. But some consciences are, in Thomas Boston's words, too pernickety. They condemn what God's word does not condemn. There's the conscience of the Jehovah's Witness concerning blood transfusions, or there are other items like that. There are other consciences which are the very opposite, and they let everything pass. They allow what God's word condemns. They are less sensitive than they should be. They are too open. There is the conscience of the inquisitor, who burns at the stake and tortures men and women out of conscience. There is the conscience of the cannibal. And all of us have to educate our consciences. The Puritan illustration of this is the sundial, which will give a correct reading only when the light of the sun shines upon it. But on a bright moonlit night, you can find a shadow upon the surface of a sundial, and it will record and give you a time. But it would be a wrong reading, because it is not a moon dial, but it is a sundial. And so you have the consensus of every age and the philosophies of men and their religions, and they cast their own light upon the beliefs of men and women. And people will then behave in accordance with the light which their consciences are given. The Word of God summons the conscience of every generation to the bar of its light and its truth. When Luther was put on trial in a diet at Worms in Germany in 1521, they brought before the Reformer arguments from their traditions and their encyclicals and church decrees. And you know that Luther replied to them, "Unless I am persuaded by means of the passages I have quoted, and unless they thus render my conscience bound by the word of God, I cannot and I will not retract, for it is unsafe for a Christian to speak against his conscience." So the Reformation was not about a free conscience, but about a conscience that had been enlightened by the Bible. The Shorter Catechism tells us the word of God is the only rule to direct us how we may glorify and enjoy God. So let's consider this doctrine, which was championed at the time of the Reformation by the Reformers, sola scriptura, scripture alone. Authority for the Bible, authority for the Christian, is to be found in the Bible alone. In what area of our living is the Scripture to be normative and authoritative? How comprehensive is its authority over us as believers? Over what part of our lives is the Word of God to regulate and control us? And the answer is over every part. The whole of my life as a Christian, as a human being, lies under the enlightenment and under the dominion of the Word of God. God's revelation to us is part of his saving work in our lives and in our congregations. So let us examine some of these areas tonight. Firstly, the Word of God is the only authority for my beliefs and my theology. If I want to know what I'm to believe about God, what he's like, his attributes, his purposes, his works, what he's done for me, what is his plan for man's redemption, the promises that he has given us as Christians, the necessary norms for daily living. The answer to all of this lies then in the Word of God. There are secret things that belong to the Lord, matters about which he has chosen not to give us any information, such as how can we know the elect before they profess faith in Jesus? How can you reconcile divine sovereignty with human responsibility? What is the date of the second coming of Jesus Christ? Why should one person's life be filled with grief as one calamity seems to beckon to another, and within a short space of time come crashing into that person's life, while another knows for years green pastures and still waters? And the Bible is silent about those things, and we too must be agnostic about them. Again, the Bible does not speak on every detail of the life of the church. The Bible doesn't give us an order of service for worship. It doesn't give us a manual for daily Bible reading. It doesn't tell us what the appropriate size of a congregation should be. But the Bible does speak about the fall of man and about predestination and about what we may do and what we may not do when a church gathers. It speaks about Adam and Eve and about hell and about male headship, so we are never to be silent or embarrassed or sheepish about these matters, but to accept them as those things that God desires us to believe and to confess. And such teaching is given to us not merely to fascinate our intellects. It is revealed in the context of our duty as creatures, our lostness as sinners, and our gratitude as the redeemed. God does not give us truth just to exercise our intellects, but for our salvation and for a life of good works which God has before ordained that we should walk in them. And we must grow in our grasp of the truth and our familiarity with the teaching of Scripture and its system of Christian doctrine. Now, it is all very well for men to speak about the perils of dead orthodoxy, and that can be a real peril. There are people, and their interest is not in the great foundational truths of the Christian faith. They are interested in the conundrum of theology. They have a fascination with that. Let's avoid that. People who are animated by the great controversial doctrines that divide Christians, that men fight over, and we must watch that spirit. But we are bound as Christians to make conscience of growing in our grasp of the content of divine revelation. God has taken such pains to give us his word. This is a revelation that men can understand, and it is our obligation to use Scripture to marinate ourselves in those fascinating truths so that we become totally familiar with them. Every Christian should know intimately the doctrines which relate to the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. He should know of the deity and the humanity of the Son of God. He should know the states of Christ, pre-incarnate, incarnate, and exalted. He should know the three offices of the Messiah: Christ the prophet, Christ the priest, and Christ the king. He should be familiar with the doctrine of justification by faith. That is, that God has constituted a righteousness in the life of his Son, Jesus Christ, and he imputes that righteousness to all that believe. And in that gracious act of justification, he declares the sinner righteous in Christ. And all of us should know that. It is the stuff of believing meditation. It is the stuff of doxology. These doctrines are not for theologians. They constitute that great body of truth that sanctifies. The Apostle Paul has a great phrase at the very beginning of his letter to Titus, the truth that leads to godliness. So why do we need the Bible? That we may grow in likeness to God. So let's be careful that we're not blown about by every wind of doctrine. Let's be careful that we do not cling to theories that cannot bear the scrutiny of the Word of God. The Bible has the intrinsic right to control us and correct us, so that the issue is not, what am I reacting against? The issue is not, what was I taught by my mother and father? The issue is not some religious experience that I've had, nor certain ideas that are very precious to me emotionally. These cannot set the criteria for what I am to believe for the rest of my life, because they are utterly circular and subjective. The issue is, what has God said? Because Scripture alone has the right to control my religious thinking. There's a distinguished actor in England called Josh Ackland, married for 50 years to Rosemary, the father of 7 children. He played the part of C.S. Lewis in the play Shadowlands. He says he has an unshakable faith in God, and he bases his experience on the fact that he and his wife were once in Africa. They were in Malawi, in a remote part of the country. And he records in the biography he has written, which is called I Must Be In There Somewhere, that one night they awoke and experienced the same emotion. One so rich, content and full, that it was beyond understanding that whatever or whoever stood at the foot of the bed was the awesome reason, and our lives were never the same. He says today, I have no idea who or what God is. I don't have a vision of God. I don't think we are intended to know who he is. I'm a hopeless churchgoer. I don't like patterns, but I consider myself a religious person. Well, now, that sad quotation presents to us a religion without words, founded upon a person's experience. It has significance for no one but himself and his wife. And the fact is that that is not enough to take us into the presence of God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. So Scripture is the authority for what we are to believe about God, the basis of our theological convictions. Secondly, Scripture has the same authority in the realm of ethics and over our daily behavior. What duty does God want of me? And the answer is obedience to his revealed will. And where is that will revealed regarding great principles of conduct and the sanctities of life? Well, it is found in the Word of God. That is the only ethical rule. We have no right to detract from it. We have no right to add to it. It is the final, definitive expression of what God says is the whole duty of man. We have heard people cry and protest that they are in a great dilemma, and that the choices that now face them are very difficult. They really don't know, they say, what is right and what is wrong. Their problem, they will tell us, is one of guidance. Yet very often, when you speak to them, you discover that their problem is not guidance at all, but it is obedience. Because the ethical passages in the Word of God are amongst the most lucid parts of Scripture. 10 Commandments, have grand simplicity about them. They are expounded by the Lord Christ in the Sermon on the Mount, and they are amplified by the apostles in the great end sections of the letters, Romans chapter 12 and Ephesians 5 and 6, and by the letter of James. They are amongst the clearest sections of Scripture. So this matter of whether I should marry a man who has no interest at all in the Christian life, who scorns the gospel, but has a pretty face and money, that is not a matter of guidance. It is a matter of obedience to God. The Lord says so clearly in his word, he must belong to the Lord, 1 Corinthians 7:39. Now, of course, that is not a sufficient criterion for marrying someone, but it is an indispensable one. So often, we make matters of our conduct problems of guidance. We plead to ourselves or to our church that our sins are not like other people's sins. Our sins are beautiful. Our sins are defensible and understandable. They're not like the rest. And time and again, we have to return to the authority of Scripture for all our daily conduct. For example, there is a sex education that is taught in the Word of God, and it's very simple. Purity before marriage and faithfulness within it. And Scripture forbids homosexual activity and even condemns homosexual desire. That whosoever looks on a man to lust after him has committed sexual sin already in his heart. And again, Scripture teaches there are a couple of grounds for divorce. There is adultery and there is diversion by the unbelieving partner. And again, it teaches that human life begins at conception and that the balance of doubt, because of the vulnerability of that person during its first weeks of life in the womb, must always be tilted in favor of the unborn child. And the same word of God, which says, thou shalt not kill, also says, whosoever sheds man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed. Genesis 9:6. So the word of God comes to us, and it tests us in the different circumstances of our lives, and it challenges our ethical obedience. Are we, as Christians, those who seek help from God to know his will and do his will day by day? Are we careful to obey the word of God when we are emotionally disinclined? Are we zealous to do what God says when we lie in the depths of depression? When we wallow in self-pity? When we know that there is a duty calling us which is unpleasant and unattractive? Have we the maturity to stamp on our negative emotions in the face of our reluctance and aversion to address ourselves to what God is clearly telling us to do? There is no greater peril in the Christian life than to make our emotions the touchstone for our duties, to wait for a warm feeling to arise before we are kind to our enemies, to wait for the moment of inspiration to fall upon us before we pray, to plead, well, God can't expect me to witness when I'm feeling the way I am today. And time and again, we have to withstand ourselves and insist on the fact that though our will is weak, and all spiritual energy has left us, we have to pull ourselves together. We have to pick ourselves up. We have to attend to the duties that God has given to us. Are we obedient in face of the tremendous difficulties and obstacles that our own feelings can place in our way? The Word of God is authoritative in the realm of ethics. And then I ask you this, is it not authoritative in the small things, as well as in the great things? Isn't it one of the true signs of maturity that we are paying careful attention to matters of detail in the Christian life? You remember how our Lord's commendation falls upon men and women who are faithful in little things. And it is at that point that so often we are losing the battle. It may not seem to you a great problem to be at the doors of a church at, say, 11 o'clock or at 6 o'clock on a Sunday. It may seem to you a trifling thing to be in your place in the prayer meeting during the week. It may be just a small matter to you to remember the work of missions and support them, to write certain letters, to call a person and sympathize or give a word of thanks to people. It's just a small thing to keep promises. But it is often in these small things that our submission to the authority of the Word of God is being tested. Thirdly, the Word of God controls our worship, the way we approach God. The question which the leadership of a congregation must ask is not, what's the most attractive form of worship? Nor, what is the most moving? Nor, what is the most fascinating to the stranger who will turn up by chance? The issue is not the most exciting worship, but simply, what is the most biblical? That is all. And should you think that the most biblical is boring, that is a fearful response. Are you getting weary of the living God? All you will have in eternity is God. The one concern of thinking through worship is, how does God want you to approach him? The issue is, what gives God most pleasure? And that's the question which every congregation must ask continually, and ask in the face of innovations that are being suggested and that shoot at us like arrows from all around us. We can't base our arguments upon the fact that our fathers worshipped in a particular way, even for centuries. We cannot plead our own feelings or such tastes as we like flickering candles, or we like silence, or we prefer a simple form of worship, or we love ritual or a certain kind of music. Those are not the questions. The question is, how does God want to be worshipped? That's the only question. It's the vital question of Isaiah 1:12. The people of Isaiah's day, they were full of religious activity. Their sacrifices, their trampling God's courts, their offering incense, and their keeping new moons, and their convocations, and their spreading out their hands to heaven. And the Lord God looked at it all and looked at it all, and finally he said to them, who has asked this of you? And God views with scorn all this religious activity. Who hath required this of you? He said, have I asked you to do all these things? When you come into my presence, have I told you? No, you be sure you act in these ways. And the people had failed to ask, what did God want from them when they gathered together in his name? What is God's will for our worship? Now, the Lord Jesus instituted two sacraments, baptism and the Lord's Supper, just two. He's asked of us, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. And there are then the many records of new converts then being baptized in the book of Acts. And then Christ also gave us the Lord's Supper. And he said, do this in remembrance of me. He didn't say, sacrifice this. He said, do this. On the first day of the week, we came together to break bread. Acts 20, verse 7. So, two sacraments, two alone, were instituted by the Son of God. So let's make sure that in our congregations we have these two ordinances, these two sacrifices, and no more. And then there are four marks of a church in Acts 2:42. They continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine, in fellowship, in breaking of bread, and prayer. And prayer is given this very significant place in the Acts of the Apostles, isn't it? And it's given as equally important a place in the New Testament letters. I urge then, first of all, that requests, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for everyone. I want men everywhere to lift up holy hands in prayer. And men today emphasize the lifting up, whereas the scripture emphasizes the holiness of the hands that are extended to God in intercession. And then Paul also says, preach the word. And as the congregation hears the word of God being opened up and applied to them, then as one minute follows the next, they are involved with God. They think, I must stop this. I must change. I must repent. Oh, thank God for Jesus Christ. Thank God. Thank you, Lord, for sending your Son. All these things in our hearts, we are responding. We are learning from him what new things we are to do in our lives and apply in practice in our lives. We are vowing to give God better obedience. We are refreshed by the word to face then another week in a hostile and a godless dark valley. We are receiving new insight. We are expressing great gratitude. We are feeling more compassion for the sinner's plight, our own family's plight. So the preaching of the word of God becomes the actual climax of covenantal worship. We sing to him and we pray to him and we look to him. And then he comes and he addresses us and speaks to us in the word of God. And so you find this extraordinary emphasis in the Acts of the Apostles about the preaching of the word. They don't come and they unload from camels and donkeys an altar and build it and then put on some religious costume and then do some ritual, and when people gather to find out what they're doing, explain to them they're reenacting Calvary. There's nothing like that. They're there and they're standing in a marketplace. Well, they're going into a synagogue and they're opening up the scriptures and they're telling people about the Lord Jesus Christ. And then they speak to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. They sing and make melody in their hearts to the Lord. And that's mentioned, Ephesians 5:19. And there is actually one reference in the Acts of the Apostles to Christians singing together, and it's in a strange place. It's in the prison at Philippi, where their backs are bruised and bleeding and their feet are in the stocks, and all the prison is hearing of their thanks and praise as they sing together and encourage one another, Paul and Silas. We cannot say, oh, there's enormous emphasis in the Bible on music. You can't say that, but it's not to be ignored. Well, those are the elements that are found in biblical worship that God requires of us in Scripture. And in presenting that response to God, we are simply doing what he asks us to do. We are under the authority of God in our worship. Fourthly, the Scriptures are authoritative for fellowship. The great Pentecost event concludes with the description of the young New Testament church and its love for one another, and its ability then to assimilate 3,000 men into 120 men that are there in Jerusalem on that day. And we're told that these thousands of new Christians, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship. And you see the picture then. There's the city walls of Jerusalem and the grassy slopes there, and you go down and there's 200-300 men, and Andrew is speaking, one of the apostles is speaking to them. He's telling them about the life of Christ, what he's seen, what he heard on the Sermon on the Mount, and how he saw Lazarus rise from the dead, and saw a man blind from birth receiving his sight, and a deaf man hearing, a leper cleansed and rejoicing, and they're listening and It's like a seminar group, and the people are full of questions. The whole city is buzzing. Why did he do that then? What did Jesus say? What did he mean by doing that? And they're growing in the whole dynamism of a congregation like this, but an apostle explaining, someone who was with Jesus from his baptism to the 40 days of his resurrection and saw him ascend to heaven. But there are skeptics, there are spies, there's a fifth column on the fringes of the crowd, not liking all this that is going on, and they are arguing with Andrew. They don't accept his interpretation of the life of Jesus. They're rejecting the teaching. And Andrew is helped by God, and he's wonderfully patient, and he sweetly smiles, and he answers them with help from heaven. The Holy Spirit gives him grace to answer them. And they reject, but they continue to reject the apostles' testimony to the life and the teaching and the resurrection and the salvation that is in the Lord Jesus Christ. And fellowship dies, doesn't it? They're religious men and they're moral men, but fellowship in the rejection of the apostolic testimony to the Lord Jesus Christ is non-existent. There is no way that it can be built and sustained if apostolic doctrine is refused. Fellowship in unity depends on fellowship in truth. And so the Bible sets out the parameters of Christian fellowship. So the apostle then, he goes on a missionary journey to Galatia, and he has birth pangs for them until Christ is formed in many of them. And then he goes off to plant a church elsewhere, and then they move in, don't they? They're always looking. The heretics are always looking. The muddled people are always looking. They can't start a church. As Spurgeon says, the modernists can't build a mousetrap. And they are there, and they come. There's a group of people. And the cult's expert in picking on novices. And they began speaking to the Galatians and saying to them, do you really want God's blessing in your life? Do you really want to serve the Lord? Do you want the smile of God upon you? Don't you know that the Lord says in his word, and says it so clearly, that we should be circumcised? Aren't there judgments on those who refuse to be circumcised? Didn't it happen to Moses himself? Also, there's the seventh day. There's not just this Lord's day, and there are food laws to keep, and there are wonderful feasts to go up to Jerusalem three times a year. Don't you want the best for yourself and your wife and your children? That God has to give you, this is the way. And the people speaking to them with shining faces and twinkling eyes and smiled and spoke with such certainty. And they had no problem with eternal punishment. And they could have gone through every phrase of the Apostles' Creed and said amen to it all. But did Paul have fellowship with them? Did Paul say, well, this is an interesting example of the ecclesiastical diversity of the rich religious tapestry that Jesus came to weave? He didn't say that. Would he approved of Richard Foster's visionary emotional state as he cries, I see a mighty river of the Spirit. I see a country pastor from Indiana embracing an urban priest from New Jersey and together praying for the peace of the world. I see a people. I see a Catholic monk from the hills of Kentucky standing alongside a Baptist evangelist from the streets of Los Angeles and together offering up a sacrifice of praise. I see a people. I don't think Paul would have been impressed with a rhetoric crying out. And I see a Judaizer circumcising the old Christian and putting that family on a kosher diet and checking up that they're keeping the seventh day of the week as a Sabbath. I see a people. It was error teaching and fellowship destroying and damnation bringing that Paul could see. Fellowship is only possible in the Spirit if there's fellowship in the truth. So what did Paul say? He said, I'm astonished. I'm amazed that you've deserted the one who called you by the grace of God and you've turned to another gospel, which is really no gospel at all. And then he takes a deep breath and he says, if we or an angel from heaven speak any other gospel, let him be anathema, let him be eternally condemned. And here are these teachers, and they live maybe better moral lives than some of us. And they were keeping themselves unspotted from the world. And they knew there was a heaven to win and a hell to lose. And these people were saying, but Jesus Christ is our Savior. What was wrong with Paul? Why was Paul being so pernickety? Why was he being a hyper-separatist? No, he wasn't any of those things. Because the very heart of Christianity and the salvation of men and women was at stake, as far as the apostle was concerned. He had no trouble with a boy being circumcised for reasons of hygiene, or for mere cultural tradition, or to remove any offense in the spread of the gospel. In fact, Paul had encouraged Timothy to be circumcised for such a reason. For the apostle, there were three steps involved in appropriating salvation. Firstly, to believe into, upon, right into the Lord Jesus Christ. And secondly, being justified, that is, being declared righteous for Jesus' sake. And thirdly, being forgiven for all your sins. And then you could be circumcised as a cultural or as an aid to evangelism in certain circumstances. The Judaizers in Galatia had a very different approach. They believed, firstly, a man believes in the Lord Jesus. Secondly, he is circumcised. And then thirdly, he is justified and pardoned. In other words, it wasn't enough to lodge your trust, to entrust yourself and all you are and all your hopes of heaven and glory into the hands of the Lord Christ. It was not an acceptable doctrine to them. The Judaizer says, oh, well, we've got to do something too. We must make our contribution. And the Lord has accomplished 95% of our salvation. But we've got 5% that we contribute. We get circumcised. We eat certain foods. We refuse others. We keep the seventh day as well as the first day, just between us and the Lord. And then we get truly right with God. And Paul is saying, if that is how you get your salvation, then you are in as hopeless a state as an unbeliever. If that is how grace comes to you, then it is no grace at all. Just as an anchor chain is as weak as its weakest link, salvation is as strong as its weakest link. And the weakest link is us and the contribution that we make. Because sin affects everything we do. I've never done anything that has not been affected by my sin. Every word we speak, every action we perform, all the sins of omission, all the imperfections of our motivation, and our best obediences are riddled with and spoiled by self. It is impossible for us to do anything 100% purely and holily and spotlessly and undefiled in the eyes of God, the God before whom the angels cover their eyes. And when he looks and evaluates anything that we do, there is sin. And if our salvation rests in part, in large part on Christ and in some part on us, we are lost men and women. We are on our way to perdition. Our part, my part. It will always let me down. For Paul, the glory of the gospel that he brought to Galatia was what he told them about our young, brave, lovely Savior. What he did all by himself, by his life of spotless submission to the law of God, by his active obedience to the moral law and the ceremonial law and the civil law, and that he gave himself and suffered and died alone. I was no help to him. He treaded out the winepress of God's wrath all by himself. By himself he purchased of our sins. And the only contribution that we made then, that we make, is our great need. That's what we give. All the fitness he requires is to see your need of him. Rabbi Duncan said, our sin is the handle by which we grasp Christ. We plead our sin and our need, and we look away and away and away to a love that will not let us go, to the inconceivable mercy, to the grace whose height and depth, the length and breadth we can't measure. We're on a precipice looking into the wonder of what God has done for us in Christ. So that church fellowship, church cooperation, it all depends on the word alone. Alone. Christ alone. Grace alone, the word of God alone, faith alone, the glory of God alone. Is it not by Christ alone we are saved? And these alones then are absolutely essential, because they give such honor and glory and praise to the God who conceived the plan of redemption and set up the whole engineering of redemption. Wave goodbye to his son as he came from heaven on that long journey into the darkness. And he pitched his tent in the valley of this world, where men crucify other men, where they blaspheme and curse and gamble as men writhe in agony attached to crosses. And he came there because he loved puny, dirty men and women like you and like me. Paul accepted the word of God that it determines our fellowship. If you want fellowship in the gospel, it has to be structured and enlightened and taught by the word of God. It is not that we are a rather particular people and non-cooperative and awkward, but that we are conscious that the word of God is to operate in every area of our lives, over our individual lives, over our family lives, over our congregational lives, and over our across congregational divides, our fellowship, our cooperation in publishing, in running a camp, in a seminary, in training men for the ministry, our magazines. There is no way that we can fellowship unless the word of God has authority over us. And finally, fifthly, the word of God has the right to control the emotional life of the Christian. The Bible is a rule then, not just for my fellowship and my ethics and my theology, but it's also a rule for my affections. My experience in the way that I react to what God has said in his word, to Christian realities, to providences and day-to-day occurrences, and to the emotional responses that are called for from me to the phone call, to the discovery of the lump. To the voice that says, sit down, I have something to tell you. And we have often been inclined to exempt that department of our lives from the authority of the Bible, and to assume that whatever the Bible says about our doctrines and about our ethics and about our worship, it doesn't deal with this mysterious and inward area of our lives which seems to us so inaccessible and uncontrollable. And that conclusion is a very great mistake. There is a great clarity in the Word of God that a certain kind of emotional life is normative for a Christian and is required by God. The fruit of the Spirit is love and joy and peace. And what are love, joy, and peace? They are emotions. What did Paul say? What does Paul say? He says, I have learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. And contentment is a normative emotional condition for the Christian. Joy, peace, contentment. And how far astray we can be in these areas. I am not sure that Christians in our congregation, in your congregation, characterized by such graces, stand as prominently as they deserve to stand, who radiate such virtues. Do we appreciate the contribution, which a man or woman controlled by these emotions makes to the life of your church week by week? Do you revere members for their contentment? Do we esteem them for their joy and peace? How we should. The extraordinary ability they have to encourage and uplift the spirit of a minister. Persons known for their sweetness, their interest in other people, that they deem other people better than themselves, that there's a fragrance that spreads through a congregation because of them. We can never forget them. And the people then who, well, they're as straight as a ramrod, but they're cold and they're hard and they leave very different memories. And that is the biblical norm for a personality at peace with itself, integrated not by birth, not by temperament, not by psychological techniques, but integrated by the grace of God. And so at peace with oneself. That's no mean achievement in the neurotic culture in which we are living. Peace with God, peace with the world around, and joy and contentment in our lives. These things are not options, which it's very nice if you can muster them, any more than it is an option for me whether I believe in the deity of Christ or not. Because God's prescription for the Christian reaches down into our hearts and souls and mind and strength, our whole psychological condition and emotional life. Let me put it in the terms of the negatives that you find in the Word of God, the great teaching of the Lord Jesus on anxiety in Matthew 6, how the Lord rebukes worry and fretfulness, the stuff that we are so familiar with day by day. The pagans run after all those things, he says. And the Lord analyzes it and he shows how incompatible it is to live a life trusting in the King of Love and then being blown about by every strange and trying providence that meets us. And Jesus is saying in Matthew 6, either faith or anxiety, you cannot have both. Remember how the Lord stands before Elijah lying there in that pit of despondency and depression, addressing him under the juniper tree. What are you doing here, Elijah? He stands before David's despondency and he says to him by the Spirit, why art thou cast down, O my soul? He stands before Cain and he says to Cain, why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? And God's word comes and it challenges depression. How can a Christian be continually depressed who believes God has put everything that touches our lives as gentle as a mother's kiss waking her sleeping child, or as powerful as an earthquake that shakes the prison and breaks the chains and opens the doors, that everything, however tiny, however enormous, must work together for our good? God has put an obligation on it to that effect. How can a Christian be characteristically melancholic while he's testifying to people, I have a loving shepherd. He provides all my needs. He's in control of my life. He makes all grace always abound to me in all circumstances. And from his love I am never, never, never separated. How can a Christian who believes that message from his heart crack up the moment some inconvenience comes into his life? And he loses his peace. He loses his cool. He loses his joy. The Savior says, why do you worry? Why do you worry about the future? Why do you worry about things over which you have no control? About the child that's in your womb, about the examination results that are going to come up. The folly of us as Christians who trust in a loving Father, dwelling on the possibilities of what might happen this winter, is so desperately unbelieving. It is so simply sub-Christian for us to behave in that way. Think of our Lord Jesus and how he speaks to us about phobias, and how he so often confronts his disciples and says to them, Why are you fearful? Why are you afraid? Yes, there's a storm, but I'm with you. The master of ocean and earth and skies, I'm with you. The enfleshment of the covenant of grace, there in the boat, in the same storm as therein. What moral right do you have to be afraid? Hasn't Christ said, let not your heart be troubled, you believe in God, believe also in me. Why then this feeling that you are useless? Why do you think like that? Why do you believe that nobody loves you? How can you entertain thoughts like that? You are the apple of God's eye. Why this feeling that no one understands you and no one likes you? The Word of God has a right to stand in judgment over my convictions, over my theology, over my fellowship, and to interrogate me. And that living Word comes to me Sunday by Sunday. And it looks at my emotions and it says, do you mean what you're singing? These wonderful words about thanksgiving and praise and all the blessings. Are you meaning those words? The scriptures have that right to challenge me, nothing else. But they do. They look at depression and fear and worry and discontent. And they do so very tenderly. God deals with us like a father dealing with his children, all our maturity and our children's fears. And, we pity them. Oh, what we'd give. Oh, if only we could give our experience of life and our strength and our confidence and give it to them as they are facing unrequited love, or no one's asked them to the prom, or whatever their troubles are. And he views us when we're weary and we sleep and we don't pray. Are you still sleeping and resting? He says, enough. How long-suffering he was with Job. With such bitterness of soul, Job blurted out his frustration and spoke so foolishly. And God comes and he lifts him up. Our Father loves us and cares for us, restores him to usefulness, restores him to blessing. Nothing can help us cope with our emotional problems like the Bible. Don't put yourself down because you seem to be failing by being painfully shy, or because of a depression that the doctors and pharmacists are helping, or because of a worrying disposition. You say, oh, my mother was a worrier, my grandmother was a worrier, and I can't help worrying too. Don't think like that. God can help people like you. God has greatly used people like you. David Brainerd was an exceptional evangelist. David Brainerd had extraordinary encouragements and fruit He had an awakening ministry. He suffered from melancholy. William Cowper, one of the greatest of all hymnists, he suffered from melancholy. Warfield's wife was an invalid throughout their marriage. But he gave himself to her and cared for her devotedly, became the great champion at the same time of supernatural religion. The Word of God. There we are, finished. Word of God. It comes with such rich divine authority, and it searches us all. Oh, we should feel humbled by it. It challenges us, it encourages us, it helps us to believe the truth, and it helps us to find love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faithfulness, meekness, self-control. It helps us. There's no secret. No secret to living the happy Christian life. There's no secret. It's written on every page of the Bible. Sit at the feet of this wonderful counselor. Sit at his feet. Say, here I am again, Lord. Oh, I wish I served you much better than I do. Restore to me the joy of your salvation. And we say it so often. I'm not what I should be. I'm not what I will be. But I'm not what I was. And I am what I am by your grace. Give me more grace then to obey the word of God. That's why you've given it. Fulfill in me what you require of me. Whatever you command, fulfill that command in me. Lord, bless your word to us now, we pray. Thank you for the Bible. Thank you that it is so demanding. And with every command, there's a promise of what you will do in us. Oh, what will we do without you? We bless you that you are a super loving Father, and that you smile and smile at us forever and ever as your children. Thank you that though we've let you down so often, you've picked us up again and again and dusted us down. We've rediscovered you. We pray, Lord, for those who have brought a juniper tree to this meeting tonight and are sitting under it now and feel terribly convicted. We pray for some who've had such sadness in these past days and their hearts are breaking. One look at Jesus and the broken heart is healed. Oh, grant that, Lord, we pray for us all. And help us to be those that are strong and can minister to the weak. Give us much patience and forbearance of those who one day will be weak ourselves and will need the strength of others to help us. Make us a blessing, we pray, in this short and uncertain earthly pilgrimage of ours. How we redeem the time. And that we esteem those who are characterized by love and joy and peace. Just thank thee over and over again that we have many in our congregations who experience and demonstrate such grace. Honor them and help us to honor them, we pray, loving God. Hear our prayers. We bring them in Jesus' name. Amen.